Someone's crying, Lord, kumbaya. Oh, Lord, kumbaya. Your time. Kumbaya.
So with you.
We assemble today to give thanks to God for the life of Marcia Erskine, a woman who lived fully, loved deeply, and served her world faithfully. The significant impact of her life is expressed by the great number of persons who are here to surround her family with love. To Michael, Rochelle, Michelle, and all members of the Erskine, Marshall, Morell, and Fowler families, it is our prayer that through the tributes, the music, reflections on God's word, you will sense the nearness and the peace of God whilst benefiting from the solidarity of those who wish you well. Mine is the privilege of sharing pastoral responsibilities today with the Reverend Canon Hartley Perrin, Custos Rotolorum of Westmoreland, and a member of the family. Friends, if you have your cell phone with you, we ask that you place your cell phone in the silent mode that we may worship God undisturbed. This service, for the most part, will flow unannounced. We ask that those who are scheduled to participate kindly note where your input is needed and respond accordingly. The peace of the Lord be with you. Let us pray. Here we are, O God, assembled in your presence to give you thanks. In you we live, in you we move, in you we have our being. From you we receive all that we need for life and godliness. In life's pathways of bliss and delight, your presence is very near to us. When the road becomes dreary, confusing, and painful, you draw even closer. Receive the worship we offer today. Send your Holy Spirit among us, that we may hear your promises and know them to be true, and so receive the comfort, peace, and hope that they bring. We pray these things through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
We take the tributes to Marcia.
It was lately that she conferred on me the unique distinction and special moniker of Uncle. Marcia Erskine was a truly extraordinary woman. Sagacious, graceful, humorous, astute, elegant, energetic, and of the finest pedigree was Marcia Paulina Erskine. Lady Louise Bennett would have described her simply as a bonanos lady. Those who really came to know her recognized that the secret and sometimes mischievous side of my niece often propelled her to have a good laugh at the expense of her most precious friends. But when I learned that Marcia, with whom we had a professional appointment at my office the following day, had left us on March 6th for the realms of glory, I recognized this was more than a cruel prank. It was an awesome reality with which all of us here gathered must endeavor to cope. This Trinity to the bone made her departure to yonder realms as a full and true blooded Jamaican. Her only shortcoming was her failure to master our 40 shilling vocabulary. She was captured, High Commissioner Murray, by the Talawa spirit and the tenacity that led to her transition to becoming an ideal and a model of the entire Caribbean woman. I attribute it to the power of love. Michael sealed the deal, and we thank you, and that forged the finest Trinijam blend. She was supremely confident and content to reflect her feminine charm, always in exquisite attire and that warm, alluring smile. She was assertive, gifted, and ingenious. She was also stately, attractive, and gorgeous. In the many eloquent and deserving tributes that have been paid in the media and online, there is one word that consistently recurs: excellence, and justifiably so. That search, that insistent and relentless pursuit of nothing but the best, is what featured in every aspect of her life and the immortal memory we must pledge to cherish and preserve. The public relations conglomerate she built brick by brick never accepted any client purely because of monetary compensation. It had to be established that the client operated for a worthy cause. It had to be something in which he genuinely believed. Issues such as promoting our Caribbean space, the human resource development of our people, and corporate enterprises devoted to ethical business practices and notable charitable endeavors. Her extensive clientele were all the beneficiaries of her superb marketing skills, of her creative literary talents and imaginative designs. She tackled any obstacle for every enterprising venture with consummate professional skills. As a client, she made you believe you were the one and only customer. The more formidable the challenge, the more resounding the advice, leave it to Marcia. But when she signs off with her delightful tilt of the Trini accent, everything is all right. You can really relax. Her deep love of the craft and her innate mastery of the requisite skills helped the firm to promote and elevate Brand Jamaica on the global hospitality stage. She was a visionary whose comprehension of the nuances of public relations helped to establish unique and distinctive brands. As we came to know, despite her amicable and calm demeanor, Marcia was no pushover. She was prepared to be a self-effacing and supportive member of the group. But yet, she was always willing and equipped to assume the mantle of leadership when the occasion deemed it necessary. To be head of the PR Association or the Women's Leadership Group required nerves of steel, as well as that special blend of knowledge and experience. As you will hear, she chaired both with admirable aplomb. In separate competitive fields, she demonstrated her belief in the power of women to lead and change the Caribbean narrative. Marcia's passion for her craft was never allowed to diminish her commitment to her family. She was a devoted wife to her husband, Michael, and a loving mother to their two children, Michelle and Rosal, her sister Anne, and the extended family for whom she was the unquestioned matriarch. Her sudden departure has not only left a terrible void in the professional realm, but will profoundly impact the lives of her beloved family and her extensive range of friends. In these moments of loss, we extend our deepest condolences to Michael, their children, and doting grandchildren, in addition to all who mourn the loss of such an extraordinary human being. As we remember Marcia Erskine, we celebrate not just her professional achievements, but the indelible mark she leaves and has left on the lives of all those she touched. Her story is one of inspiration, a reminder of the impact one individual can make on their community, on an industry, and our single Caribbean space. May Marcia's legacy continue to inspire generations to come, guiding us toward a future where dedication, passion, and leadership illuminate the path which we must follow. We who were privileged to have known her will always treasure Marcia's memory and be inspired and motivated by her exemplary dedication to giving so fully of herself during her earthly sojourn. Even as she rests in eternal peace, Marcia Paulina Erskine will bring radiance and joy to the celestial kingdom which she has now entered.
It was the great Indian lawyer, Mahatma Gandhi, who said, and I quote, "The best way to find yourself is to lose yourself in the service of others," end quote. These words exemplified how Marcia lived her life. Today I'm here to share about my very dear friend, a big sister, founding board member, an associate who I sometimes refer to as Auntie Marcia. I could use many adjectives to describe the friendship I have had with Marcia, otherwise known to me and many others as Emmy, her customary signature. But most importantly, I'm here to talk about the work we did together for Jamaica's most vulnerable, namely children in state care. I met Marcia Erskine while working for British Airways in New York. It was there that I formed a not-for-profit organization in 1994 called Children of Jamaica, COJA, our mission to assist Jamaica's underserved children in state care. A few years later, I was heading to Jamaica to do a presentation at the then Marigold Child Care Facility. And the head of British Airways Public Relations for the Americas introduced us by telephone. Marcia was on hand for the presentation, wrote a press release, and that was the beginning of a relationship which lasted for 3 decades. Marcia was COJA to the core, a dedicated advocate for COJA's mission and vision. We share the same passion that the nation's greatest resources are its children, and we must work together to ensure that every child is given the opportunity to live up to his or her God-given potential. In 1994, COJA donated money to build a library at the Glen Oak Nursery for the kids. Marcia was again present for the handover, the groundbreaking ceremony in 2001, and the official opening of the library in 2002. Although Marcia had her own business, COJA was like a paid client. I often joke with her, saying, "That's the reason we pay you the big bucks." Many of you who gathered here today may not know about Marcia's charitable giving, which cannot be measured. However, Marcia was on board for all of COJA's activities and programs. She traveled to New York for COJA annual gala held in December. She was responsible for sourcing guest speakers, including the Honorable P.J. Patterson, Honorable Lisa Anna, the late Professor Rex Nakeford, the late Barbara Glodden, Senator Don Webby, Honorable Alone Assemble, and Honorable Ed Bartlett, just to name a few. On many occasions, Marcia was instrumental in escorting journalists from Jamaica to New York and hosting them for various Koja events. In 2012, the Koja Scholarship Awards Luncheon was established to assist children in state care who are enrolled in or matriculated to pursue tertiary studies at institutions across the island. Marcia was again present. To date, Koja has awarded over $300,000 in scholarship, empowering these children for a better tomorrow. In 2021, during the COVID pandemic, Koja donated just under 200 devices to the CPFSA's One Laptop, One Tablet Per Child initiative. Marcia was again present. Last year, Marcia traveled to New York to participate in our fundraising summer soiree on Long Island. There was no Koja event where Marcia wasn't present. She has left many templates for Koja to follow. This is part of her legacy. At the end of February, I was heading down under on vacation, only to receive a call from Emmy while connecting in LA. She was inquiring about plans for our upcoming Scholarship Awards luncheon next month in Kingston. Little did I know that would be our last conversation. As my vacation was wrapping up, I received calls from a few friends inquiring as to my whereabouts and asked that I contact them on my return to the US. Soon after, I got a call from my communication director saying he had some very sad news to share. I recall the shock, numbness, which overcame me after hearing the news. Marcia's passing has left a void. I have not been the same since. As many of you here today know, she is irreplaceable. To honor her work and legacy, Koja will be presenting the Marcia Ersin Scholarship in her honor. The first presentation will take place at our upcoming Scholarship Awards luncheon next month. And in closing, remember, mourn her not for too long, but rejoice forever that she was.
Good afternoon. For Marcia, our Mars, our M. Some people you don't know well or long, but unforgettably. They fit and fill a space with gentle insistence that is timeless, warm, and welcome. This we knew of Marcia and will not soon forget. It is enough that we journeyed with our friend and our sister. So, our dearest sister, M, how, what, when? How, Marcia, how do your WLI sisters even begin to say thank you? First, for your stellar and long-standing service to the United Way of Jamaica, our parent organization, and closer to home for your utter and unwavering devotion to the WLI and its sisterhood, for believing in us so passionately and refusing to let it wane, even when many of us thought it just might, for recognizing always that together we needed to believe in our work first, and that only then would true sisterhood sustain us, for the sheer brilliance with which you conceptualized and showcased our work over the past 20 plus years so that we could always stand proud, for your humility, never seeking the stage, but confidently leading from the back, the middle, and ever so subtly from the front. For literally never saying no or I can't, you simply always were there. For being our glue, our visionary, our conductress, our go-to, our shepherdess, and I have to slip this one in, for what to wear, go-to, and our friend. For making each and every one of us feel that we were the only one you spoke to on any given day, that you were just checking in and had all the time in the world. What, Miss Marcia, what do we do when we need a little encouragement, a voice of reason? What do we do without that place where you made us feel safe, not judged, even when you forced us to look within ourselves for the answers? What do we do when we cannot hear that chuckle or see you beam with love, pride, and untold joy, your eyes smiling as you shared pictures or regaled us with the last family adventure? They were always first for you, your everything. We know you loved them beyond measure. What do we do to honor your tenacity, your compassion, and tireless commitment to the lives of women and children that the WLI seeks to make better? What do we do to pay it forward, your favorite mantra, in your memory? And finally, when, Marcia, when do we raise ourselves from this awful grief we feel without you? You would say, girl, when is now? Just push through like I always did. Do our work. Don't say we can't. Find a way. It's not about you. It's what you do that counts. She would say, believe in your sisters. I found many gems in many of you. Find more. She would say, be kind. You never know what people are going through. You would tell us, Marcia, that true legacy is continuity, not memories. And so, Marcia, M. Mars, our amazing, beautiful soul sister, we will. We will hold you up always as our standard bearer. We will not let the WLI and our sisterhood falter. We will continue to cherish and take pride in our work and each other. We have no choice. It is what you would have wanted. It will never be enough without you. The WLI extends our deepest sympathies to Michael, Rochelle, Michelle, Zwadi, Sule, and Nyla, and to the Erskine, Mentor, and Marshall families, as well as to her devoted assistant, Tracia, who has been supportive of the WLI for many, many years. We are deeply grateful for the privilege of sharing our love for Marcia today. Know that we will hold her in our hearts always, and that we will continue our work in her honor. Now I can absolutely feel her beside me saying, hello, miss, enough. They gave you 5 minutes, tick tock. We love you, Marcia.
I must confess that I thought hard and long before breaking the protocol, the cardinal sin of breaking the protocol of sharing a WhatsApp communication. But this was our last communication. This was a communication the day before she passed. She wrote, "Vice Chancellor, see attached. My daughter is making big waves in the USA. My response, I am reliably informed that the sweetest fruit never falls but under the tree and always stays there." Her response, "Vice Chancellor, thank you for your perpetual kindness. I will always appreciate it. Bye-bye for now." I inherited the media services of Marcia from my predecessor, Professor Harris, who is here. I had known of her reputation, but I knew little of her personality. We met in my office. I knew that I would need, going forward, her public relations skills. And she knew that more acutely than I did. I had to negotiate the terms and conditions of our relationship very carefully. She was, after all, a classmate of Mary, my wife, at Carrimack, just a block away from here. And so we got down to it. She was frontal and she was precise. She said, "Vice Chancellor, the decision of the heads of government to ask you to lead the Regional Reparations Commission will complicate your role as Vice Chancellor." And I asked, why is that? "Because," she said, "the powers to be in this region are not reparations ready." That statement dropped like a bomb. I was on the back foot. And of course, when you're on the back foot, your instinct is to return to first base. And my first base is history. And so I said, "Well, Marcia, the UWI started in 1948 as a medical school dedicated to repairing the health of West Indian people. Because the health of West Indian people was considered the worst in the British Empire. Therefore," I said, "Marcia, we are in the repair business. And whether we like it or not, this is our business. We are here not only to repair, but to repurpose our people's labor and intellect, and to repurpose that intellect for sovereignty and statehood. We are also in the business not only of repairing and repositioning, but creating the context for a dignified future. And of course, I started to preach. And she stopped and she said, "Vice Chancellor, you are preaching to the Pope." I am a UWE graduate to the bone. While we spoke about the nobility of the UWI, embedded in its mission, and the dignity of our determination, I saw in her that personal pride and that precise sense of purpose. I saw in her that personal dignity and nobility that drew me to her and became the bedrock of my deep respect. Her commitment to this university's vision and mission was everywhere evident. Her role as media consultant to the Vice Chancellor meant that her task was to project our vision. And from time to time, more often than she had anticipated, to protect us from the non-progressive forces in our societies. Juggling the need to project and to protect was a mind-altering task, yet she did it for us with that illuminating smile, that social savvy that disarmed even the non-believers. Take, for example, her running to the aid of Anne-Marie Grant, who is here, our director of the North American UWI Foundation, foundation that has raised millions of dollars over the decades for needy West Indian students. The foundation has just lost its two patrons, Sir Sidney Poitier and the Honorable Harry Belafonte. We no longer had our founding patrons to consult. Marcia took on our New York project, and with Anne-Marie became a powerful force in the city of New York. Our annual gala next week, Thursday, will not be the same without her, but we will celebrate her spirit and we will rise in recognition of her service. She has been a scribe of our strategy, the face of our audacity, and the essence of what it is to be a member and a graduate of the university community. Today, the University of the West Indies pays tribute to the nobility of this matriarch, to the dignity of this highly acclaimed graduate and a champion of our collective cause. We offer condolences to her families and all of her dear friends. May her soul rest in peace.
So, Martha Erskine, when she called the phone, "Hey boy, what you do?" I said, "Miss Erskine, is you?" "Yes, no ramping me, no boy." That's what I know her. Yeah, so that's the way I know Marcia. She call you, she want you to do a job. Hey, what you do? Are we talking about money? And money, she say, hey, that's it. And keep it. And make sure you're on time. Make sure you're not late. No ramping me, no boy, no ramping me. It treated that, you know, sound. Yeah? But may her soul rest. You live, you die. God is God. This song.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. If you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time, help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak, if you shine a little light, give sight to the one who lost their way, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, yeah. Master, when you get there, Jesus has to hold it. And I believe now your days down here all through, there's a place up there for people like you. If you walk around with your heart on your sleeve, and if you try to be the change you want to see, if you lay down your life for love so someone could be saved, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold. Master, when you get there, my Savior had to hold them. And we believe now your days down here all through, there's a place up there for people like you.
Michael. Michelle, Rochelle, Squatty, the Erskine family, friends, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I stand here before you both honored and saddened. All of us today, right here, can agree that Marcia is one of the finest exports from Trinidad to Jamaica. Many of us would dare to go further and say she was one of the finest exports, period. An exemplar of the vitality and magnanimity of Caribbean people. Marcia's graciousness struck a chord with all those who met her. Her kindness marked her out as a good soul. She endeared herself to us all, not because she felt compelled to leave you with an impression. She simply had no qualms about who she was. It's a rare quality, and those who possess it are truly blessed. Marcia possessed it and was blessed. Let's all ponder on Marcia. Can you ever recall an instant where you feared her vituperative tongue, where she was quick to diminish you, the slightest infraction drawing her ire, that she was quick to scold or reprimand? Never. Not at all. Do you ever have to ask yourself, what Marcia am I going to get today? You always got the Marcia who greeted you with that infectious smile and those lovely aqueous eyes. She did have those beautiful Betty David eyes. She was all bonhomie. She made you feel all was right with the world. Marcia, whether she was aware of it or not, made you reach for your better self. She wasn't one to languish in doom and gloom. She never sought refuge in darkness and would not allow you to either. Marcia was solution-oriented, always upbeat. She opted for the sunny side of life. Hang on a minute. Always empathetic. She was a marvelous friend, and we all need a few of those. Marcia's support and friendship was guaranteed. You could count on it regardless of the circumstances. That makes Marcia someone to be cherished. If you possessed a modicum of decency and was at the very least someone who could share her disposition, you'd be inclined to willingly reciprocate because, after all, it was Marcia. For all the years Marcia resided in Jamaica, she never lost that melodious Trini lilt. It singled her out, and we all loved it. She reminded us of our Caribbeans, and she embodied what this region could be. Marcia was always dedicated and built an admirable career, first as a journalist, then as a communications professional. For Marcia, that was apropos. Communicating effectively came naturally to her. She was never opaque, ambiguous, or given to obfuscation. With singular clarity, she cut to the chase, distilling and conveying information succinctly. That talent never left her and served her well for decades. Here again, Marcia's steadfastness manifested itself. As a youngster in Trinidad, she started out as a reporter, a graduate of the Caribbean Institute of Mass Communications, what is CARIMAC today. She served spells at the Trinidad Guardian, the Trinidad Express, the Gleaner here in Jamaica, and went on to make contributions to a host of publications. She was a press officer in the Prime Minister's office. Today we all know the Gleaner Honor Awards. Marcia was instrumental in getting it off the ground. Those years served her well, for she went on to form her own PR and communications consultancy company, Marcia Erskine and Associates. Now allow me to tarry a while on that. Marcia Erskine and Associates. What Marcia did here was to place her imprimatur on the services she offered. Clients were not simply getting professionalism, they were also getting Marcia and all that was about. She was not just a corporate entity that served to place a patina of wholesomeness and spread the good word on her clients. Many times, Marcia would go above and beyond, tirelessly ensuring that her clients got maximum value and then some. It's no wonder they remained with her for years. The likes of the University of the West Indies, British Airways, CIBC, Jamaica Institute of Engineers, United Way, Jamaica Hotel and Tourist Association, ESPN Caribbean, Restaurants Associates Limited. Marcia ran a good business, and with the trusted and loyal Tracia, was a marvelous standard bearer for Caribbean PR firms. Now to the associates part. It is said that you can judge a person by the friends they associate with. Marcia had some outstanding friends, and some are here today. I do hope they may forgive me as I single a few of them for honorable mentions. Christine King, Prudence Simpson, Diane Corey, Minna Israel, Eva Lewis, Lystra Sharp, Novia McDonald-White, Yvonne Wilkes. These are not only women who were leaders in their field, who have distinguished themselves, but they also happen to be charming and delightful. It comes as little surprise that they were in Marcia's orbit. In the early noughties, we did some journalist trips to big cities like London and Barcelona, organized by Marcia and Diane. They were memorable, and I remember them always. We had a blast. Marcia was the consummate traveling companion, attentive, vivacious, stylish, humorous, the life of the party, and there were a few. I recall a trip to London's Vinopolis, where we learned all about looking for legs with red wine. We had a fair few glasses that day, a delightful way to spend an afternoon. Marcia had to prop me up that day. Her family meant everything to her. Marcia was devoted to and proud of her husband, Michael, her son, Michelle, AKA Young Lion. He's now helmed the family restaurant and has taken the reins of the business that Marcia built. He has a quick wit and charming manner, just like Marcia. Marcia took immense joy from her daughter Rochelle's accomplishments. Rochelle is a mom to two beautiful kids, Nyla and Suli, with her husband, Dr. Zoadi Marshall. Rochelle was recently appointed chief counsel, privacy, security, and data strategy for Alphabet subsidiary Verily. Verily is a company that specializes in life sciences research. On Valentine's Day this year, Marcia sent me a WhatsApp which read, "Guess who's mentioned in Politico?" I put down my cup of tea to find out. Rochelle Marshall, there's nothing like a proud mama. The apple doesn't fall too far from the tree, as they say. Marcia and Michael produce fine children who have gone on to be upstanding citizens, making their way in the world. Well done yet again, Marcia. Marcia became a grandmother known as Amma by Suli and Nyla. She loved them dearly. So here we are, and we can attest to a life well lived by Marcia. Loving, kind, generous, a true friend, a matriarch, a touring partner, a loving wife, a mother, to decent, well-grounded children, a grandmother, a journalist, a businesswoman, a proud daughter of Trinidad and Tobago, a Caribbean queen. To those of us that she bids farewell, we will forever hold Marcia dear to our hearts. Shortly after midnight on New Year's Day this year, Marcia sent me a message. Poignant words from Anne Frank. What a wonderful thought it is that some of the best days of our lives haven't happened yet. Let's all keep that in mind. Now, Marcia was like a big sister to me. And as a big sister, she witnessed my transition from a scallywag of a young man to a somewhat more tempered man who started a family. And like Marcia, came to Jamaica, started a family, was a journalist, looking to get into business, and she left a big footprint. What's real can never die, and you only get what you give. Marcia gave a lot, undoubtedly. Rest well, my sister. Thank you very much.
If you are so able, may I invite you to stand, please. The grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
I shall not fail you or forsake you, says the Lord. Jesus said, I will be with you always, even to the end of time.
Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. We brought nothing into this world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gives, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Blessed are they that mourn, they shall be comforted. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. One thing I ask of the Lord, it is the one thing that I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord, and to seek him in his holy temple. The souls of the righteous are in God's hands. No torment will ever touch them. They are at peace. We lift our voices together in singing the afternoon hymn. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, hail thee as the sun above. Like the clouds of silence and rest, drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of immortal health, fill us with the light of day. All thy works with joy surround thee, earth and heaven reflect thy rays, stars and angels sing around thee, center of unclothed praise. Field and forest, hill and mountain, blossom and meadow flashes, mountain. Mortals join the mighty chorus which the morning stars began. Father, love is reigning o'er us, joining people hand in hand.
ever sing it, much beyond worth it, just in the midst of sound.
Joyful music, in the triumph song of life.
As together we affirm accompaniment, let us pray this psalm together. The Lord is my constant companion. There is no need that he cannot fulfill. Whether his course for me points to the mountaintop of glorious joy or to the valleys of human suffering, he is by my side. He is ever present with me. He is close beside when I tread the dark streets of danger. And even when I flirt with death itself, he will not leave me. When the pain is severe, he is near to comfort. When the burden is heavy, he is there to lean upon. When depression darkens my soul, he touches me with eternal joy. When I feel empty and alone, he fills the aching vacuum with his power. My security is in his promise to be near me always and in the knowledge that he will never let me go.
Our Father, who art in heaven, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on the earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us all our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from all that is evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever and ever and ever. Amen, amen, it shall be so. Sing with me, amen. Amen, amen, it shall be so. Hallowed be thy name.
Having been sitting, I invite us to stand. Please refer to the order of service. Life has set the stamp of individuality on your soul. You are different from any other person that ever lived. Man, the real man, birthless, deathless, and changeless. You are you, and you are eternal. Therefore, do not wait for immortality. Death is just the passing to a higher sphere of life and action. Begin to live today as if you are the immortal being, and all thoughts of death, all fear of change, will strip away. We're not going to attain immortality. You are immortal. Our contention is not that the dead live again, but that the living never die. So now, let us step out of the tomb of uncertainty into the light of eternal day. Praise the God for truth that sets us free. You may be seated.
Can we? I promise no more crying. I don't know where that came from.
Your grace and mercy brought me through. I'm leaving this moment because of you. I want to thank you and praise you too for your grace and mercy brought me.
I want to hear the church sing the same thing now.
Your grace brought me through, That's why we're here today. I'm leaving because of you, And I want to thank you, I want to and praise you too, And for your grace and mercy brought me through.
Same key, Harold. Same key.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up, before I lay my head, for I will sing of the goodness of God.
Come on, let's take off the roof, everybody. Let's take off the roof.
All my life you have been faithful. God has been faithful. All my life you have been so. with every breath that I am able. For I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voices. You've led me through the fire. And in darkest nights, you are close like no other. I know you as a father, yeah. And I know you as a friend. For I am lived in the goodness of God. Everybody help me sing the chorus, yeah. All my life you have been faithful. God has been faithful, yeah, yeah. And all my life God has been so, so. With every breath that I am able, for I will sing of the goodness of God. Let's sing now. Your goodness is running after. Is running after me. God's goodness is running after. Is running after me. All my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything now. Your goodness is running after. Is running after me. All my life, God has been faithful. And all my life, God has been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, for I will sing of the goodness of God. For I will sing of the goodness of God. Fly away home to Zion. Fly away home. Marcia, fly away home to Zion, fly away home. This bright morning, now your work is over. Mama, fly away home. One more time, fly away home. To Zion, fly away home. Marcia, fly away home. To Zion, fly away home. This bright morning, now your work is over. Fly away
of my dear mother. My mother was light, energy, and joy. She was confident. She was my confidant, my friend, my cheerleader, my partner in crime, my backative, as we'd say. But most of all, she was my beloved mommy. And to lose her so suddenly it's left me bereft. Struggling to make sense of it and trying very hard to cope. But she made me promise that there would be no wailing and gnashing of teeth when her time came, and that I'd wear some color, which we can debate how well I complied, and that I'd focus on happy times. So I'm trying. I'm trying to remember the good times, the countless memories, her legacy, her personal legacy, the legacy a mother leaves to her child. I've been thinking a lot about that legacy. It's a legacy of devotion. She showered me with such boundless love, unwavering support, and profound guidance that I can't find a single thing to wish she had done differently. It's a legacy of strength. She equipped me with not just the essentials, but with the tools to navigate life's challenges with grace and resilience. A legacy of love. She didn't just tell me she loved me, but demonstrated it through every action, sacrifice, and there were plenty of those, and every tender moment. A legacy of building friendship and community. Her nurturing embrace fostered not only my growth, but the growth of everyone fortunate enough to know her. A legacy of pride and support. She celebrated my successes with unbridled joy. I know some of you got bombarded with every milestone, no matter how small, on WhatsApp. But she also shared in my sorrows with unwavering compassion. I'd sometimes call her crying, and she'd start crying too before she found out what we were crying about. I used to laugh and say that she was famous for using the royal we. Are we done having kids? When are we going back to work? Are we taking our vitamins? But in truth, she always made me feel like a we, that we were in this thing called life together. She welcomed my chosen path in life with open arms, although it didn't mean that she had opinions. And opinions or no, she was so welcoming, embracing my loved ones as her own, and weaving a tapestry of love and connection that will endure for generations. She prepared me, loved me, nurtured me, and now she's left me. And I miss her beyond reason. But I'm trying to take comfort in that all I have to do is miss her. And though the pain of her absence often feels overwhelming, it pales in comparison to the gratitude for having known such an extraordinary woman. There are no regrets, only cherished memories and a legacy of love that will never fade. It will never fade because in a way she lives in me, in Mashel, in my children, in all who loved her and whose lives she touched. I'll keep your memories alive, Mommy. So Nyla and Sule will remember you and learn the lessons you've spent over 40 years teaching me. So rest easy. Thank you for imprinting my life with your boundless love, wisdom, and grace. I will love you forever. I will miss you forever. I wish we had more time together, but it was enough. Thank you for everything, Mommy. And to honor her legacy of love, community, and mentorship, we as a family are endowing a $15 million Jamaica Scholarship Fund in her name with the American Foundation University of the West Indies. The Marcia Erskine Scholarship Fund will help create and educate the next wave of women journalists at the University of the West Indies, so she will live on. And we invite you all to embark on this journey with us. In your programs, you'll find the information and link to the foundation's page. If you're so moved, we welcome you. Thank you.
afternoon, church. Let me say that again. Good afternoon, church. This is my grandson, Sule Jabari Marshall. So when Sule heard of the sudden and unexpected death of his beloved grandma, whom he calls Ama, he was devastated. It hit him like a bomb. You mean to say I'm not going to see Ama ever again? Was the question he asked. This was the first time he was experiencing the death of a close family member. And for those of you who knew Marcia well, you know that her grandchildren, Sule and Nyla, was the pride and joy of her life. So after grieving for a few days, and after hearing all the talk in the family about the funeral, Sule decided that he was going to write his own reflections of his grandma, Ama. So Sule wrote his reflection. And I believe, I honestly believe, he was quite prepared to come to the funeral and read to you what he had written until the moment he asks his dad what I consider to be the fatal question. Dad, how many persons do you believe is going to be at Ama's funeral? His dad, being the honest father he is, said to Sule, I believe it's probably going to be about 300 or more persons that is going to be there. 300 or more was his response. His reaction, in my view, is quite understandable, because I don't know which 8-year-old child would not get cold feet and emotionally traumatized in coming before a large gathering to deliver a speech at such an occasion as this. Which is how I came into the picture. Because Sule then said to me, Papa, which is what he calls me, will you read what I wrote about Grandma Ama at the funeral? Now you will notice that my name does not appear on the program, because I had absolutely no intention of doing any such thing at all. But how could I look at this sweet, innocent little boy and tell him, no, I can't read his reflections that he wrote about his grandma? The real question, though, that puzzled me is, I don't know why Sule believed that I would be in any better emotional state than he was to come up here and do anything at all. If only for him, I have to be strong. Anyway, I cannot deny my grandson's request, which explains my presence here at the podium. I will now read Sule's reflection of his grandma, Ama. My Ama was the best ever. She always made me feel like I was the most special person in the world. Every time she read to me and my sister or visited us, it was like stepping into a magical world where anything was possible. Last year, we visited Disney Magic Kingdom with her, and we had the best time ever with her. Ama's smile could brighten up my sad days when I was unhappy. and her hugs made everything okay again, even when mommy and daddy are mad at me. I will miss her yummy treats and her funny stories, but most of all, I'll miss her love and kindness. She'll always have a special place in my heart, and I'll never forget all the happy times we had with her. Amma is amazing. May her soul rest in peace, and may life light perpetual shine on her. Before we take our exit, allow me, please, to make one small but important request of you all. Shortly after Marcia's death, her secretary of over 25 years, Tracy Miller, became ill and was hospitalized. She underwent major surgery, and just Wednesday of this week, she was released from the hospital. I'm asking you all to pray for Tracia, that she will make a full and speedy recovery and return to her family in good health. And Tracia is here. I am deeply appreciative of the fact that despite all that you have been through, you made a sacrifice and the effort to be here today. Thanks much. It means a lot to us. And I want you all to just big up Tracia and give her all the love. Thank you all.
Good afternoon, everyone. Most of you would know me as Marshall Erskine. Others might know me as Papi. Some might know me as One Son. But you'd be hard pressed to find a bigger wash belly than me. Time for mama. All right. This poem that I'm about to read was written by my mom's very good friend, Melissa Makarj, who is a fellow member of the Women's Leadership Initiative. Before I read the poem, however, please allow me, on behalf of my family, to express my profound thanks and gratitude to all of you who took the time to extend good wishes and condolences to my family. I know I didn't always answer. Believe me, these words of condolences and good wishes have been a blessing and a source of comfort in these very difficult times. The poem is entitled Ode to Marcia, and it captures the very essence and the true character of my mom. Thanks again, Melicia. Your poetic skills are awesome. I might not be able to read it as well as she would have, but today is my day, right? Okay. In the realm of media, a beacon shone bright. Marcia, your essence was a pure guiding light. From Trinidad's shores to Jamaica's embrace, your spirit traversed, leaving a lasting trace. Dedicated to your craft with unwavering grace, your authenticity a cherished embrace. Passionately and lively, laughter always in your wake, in living your joy did partake. A professional woman with wisdom profound, empowering woman with voices resound, advocating for children, their rights held dear, your advocacy rang true and crystal clear. Through waves of communication, your message did soar, uniting people forevermore. In Marcia, brilliance we did find, a legacy cherished for all of time. Yet now, a somber shadow falls. For Marcia's absence, grief enthralls. Her vibrant spirit, laid to rest, leaves an emptiness profoundly expressed. In the tapestry of life, her thread now gone, leaving mourning at dawn. Oh, how deeply she will be missed, but we carry on, for it would have been her wish. May her soul...
May her soul rest in peace, and may light perpetually shine on her. Amen. Mom, I'm confident that I, through the grace of God, will see you again when we meet in heaven.
Amen. The hymn, It Is Well With My Soul.
When peace like a attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well. Soul, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ hath regarded my helpless estate, and hath shed his own blood for my soul.
It is well with my soul.
It is well. It is well with my soul.
My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought.
My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul.
It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul.
The scripture reading will be from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 to 13. Love suffereth long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself, is not puffed up, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. Beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Love never faileth, but whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spoke as a child, and I understood as a child. I thought as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know even as I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, love, these three. But the greatest of these is love, the word of the Lord.
The second lesson for today comes to us from John 14, verses 1 through 6 and 27. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? And Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Verse 27. Peace I leave with you, and my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, and neither let it be afraid. Today, Marcia's spirit is with us. She inspires us. And as we mourn the untimely departure of our beloved, we are forced to confront the harsh reality of her being here no more. But the impact that she made on the world will endure for generations. Marcia's story is a reminder that true greatness lies not in wealth or power, but the ability to touch the lives of many with love and kindness. And that was Marcia. Asse.
So at this time, we will be waiting on you for an offering towards the Women's Leadership Initiative, as well as the United Way of Jamaica, which were to the heart of Marcia Erskine. As Oliver Samuels would say, give generously. The offering will be taken while the steel pan from Trinidad, no doubt, will play. I invite us to stand as we offer. These are gifts. Eternal Lord and Father, you have given us so many things. You have given us life. And in Jesus Christ, you have taught us how to live. We thank you for this money, for the cause for which it will be given. We pray you now to bless our hearts, bless our homes, and bless our hands, that this money may be used to your honor and your glory, and for the advancement of your kingdom, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please remain standing, until the minister says you can sit.
I presume I'm the minister of whom he speaks. You may sit. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Won't you whisper a prayer with me? Let us pray. Speak your word to our hearts in this moment, O God, that in hearing you we may sense the nearness of your presence. Grant that this ignoble lump of clay may declare your heart's truth to us, and grant that we may have the grace to receive your word, for Christ's sake. Amen. Today, as we meet to remember Marcia Erskine, there is one word that I want us to consider. It is a word that I'm very uncomfortable with. It is a word that elicits various emotions. It is a word that characterizes many of life's experiences. It is a word to be found in St. Matthew chapter 8, verses 23 to 26. Listen. And tell me if you identify the word. Then he got into the boat, and his disciples followed him. Suddenly, a furious storm came up on the lake, so that the waves swept over the boat. But Jesus was sleeping. The disciples went and woke him, saying, "Lord, save us, we're going to drown." He replied, "You of little faith, why are you so afraid?" Then he got up and rebuked the winds and the waves, and it was completely calm. Have you identified my uncomfortable word? Suddenly. Suddenly. The text says that Jesus and his disciples were making their way across the Sea of Galilee when suddenly, without warning, a furious storm came up on the lake. I do not like that word, suddenly. I don't like the word suddenly because I'm a planner. I like things to move along an organized trajectory. So for me, any experience of suddenly is a threat to my peace of mind. An experience of suddenly is a threat to my expected outcome. Any occurrence of suddenly takes me off guard, destabilizes me, and sometimes immobilizes me. Marcia died suddenly. There's something intrusive and interrupting about suddenly. My ability to think straight and to function properly is interrupted. And you and I know that when the normal course of life is interrupted, then anxiety and worry are not afar off. Maybe I should ask you, how do you deal with the suddenlies of life? How is Michael and Michelle and Rochelle and the entire family to deal with this matter of suddenly? At one point you're preparing for a celebratory event, and then suddenly we're planning for a funeral. At one time, the waters of life are calm and the ship is making its steady progress to shore, but suddenly a storm comes. At one point, you're feeding in the meadows of the still waters of contentment, but suddenly you find yourself walking through the valley of the shadow of distress and divorce and disease and unemployment and illness and death. And probably that is why we should never disregard or decry someone else when they are going through their suddenly, because today for me and tomorrow for you. You see, my friend, the truth of life is this: we're either entering a storm, in a storm, or coming out of a storm. And do you know what I've come to accept? Suddenly is a reality of life. It shows no partiality. Suddenly doesn't care if you are male or female, black or white, rich or poor, educated or not so educated, Christian or not. It doesn't matter your station in life. Suddenly interrupts and imposes itself on you and me. Suddenly. It highlights how uncertain this matter of life is. And it underscores how fickle you and I are. It reminds us that we are not ultimately in charge. So the question is, how do you and I deal with the interrupting and imposing nature of suddenly? There are three little things I want to share with you with the 10 minutes that I have. When you and I face the suddenlies of life, we need a supportive network. My friends, community is at its best when you and I are at our worst. I want you to notice that Jesus made his way into the boat and his disciples followed him. Not one, not two, all of his disciples. And who were these disciples? Two sets of brothers, James and John, Peter and Andrew, plus others whose friendship was forged by their connection with Jesus. And notice that when the storm came, they were all together. They all shared the concern for life. They all shared the fear for the future. The burden of safety was borne by them all. Now, there's a point that you and I should not miss, and it is this. No one should seek to handle the interrupting force of suddenly alone. None of us should leave anyone to face the destabilizing force of suddenly alone. We were created for community, and Marcia was a community woman, and she would let you and me understand that no one is an island, no one stands alone. Each one's joy is joy to me, each one's grief is my own. We need one another. It is from community that we draw strength to face the trials of life. It is from the community that we find energy to live one more day. It is in community that we find shoulders to lean on and arms to hold us. It is in community that we find the listening ear and receive the words of comfort and assurance. So I believe this little text is suggesting that we are to ensure that our family bonds and our bonds of friendship are strong, because when the suddenlies of life come, we are going to need somebody. May we never forget that we are sisters and brothers. Regardless of how we look, regardless of where we are, we're walking the same road of life, breathing the same God-given air. And if we pause long enough to look in each other's faces, we will see the imprint and the image of the divine. And I must say how pleased I am to watch the beauty of community manifest itself by the various calls and the visits that the family would have received. People from all over the world have been calling and praying with them. You who are here and those joining online, you stand in solidarity with this family, allowing them to know that they are not alone, even as they face the suddenlies of this experience. But I want to encourage us to offer this support continually after this Thanksgiving service. It must continue, because they will feel the pang of suddenly every time Marcia's birthday comes around. And every time their wedding anniversary comes, and every time the child or the children, the grandchildren have a celebration in their lives, when we face the suddenlies of life, we need a supportive network. So I've gone 2 minutes out of my 10 minutes. When we face the suddenlies of life, I want to suggest that not only do we need a supportive network, but we need a savior. You know, something about the little text excites me. These disciples are in a boat, and the boat is on water. That's 150 feet deep. Now, at least four of them operated fishing businesses, so rough seas shouldn't really disturb them. It is said that the body of water was prone to some 30-foot waves, because of a wind that would rush around the mountain and cause the waters to swirl. And the disciples knew this. All was calm when they set across the 13-mile lake. But suddenly, a violent storm breaks out. And I have a very vivid imagination, so you will forgive me if I wonder to myself if Peter and Andrew and James and John used their seafaring experiences and skills to try and solve the problem. I believe they did. Did Matthew, the tax collector, use his mathematical genius to ensure that the bodies on the boat were well balanced so that the boat didn't topple? Maybe he did. But do you know what this little text is saying to you and me? There are some events in life that our resources are inadequate to meet. Listen, it doesn't matter the quality of my mental or material resource. There are some things my resources cannot handle. There are some experiences of life that our technical competence cannot handle. It does not matter how scholastically or experientially qualified we are. I could have more degrees than a thermometer. There are some issues and experiences in life that don't make sense and cannot be solved by intellectual acumen. There are some suddenlies in life that money is useless for. Money can buy the best health care, but it cannot buy life. And in those times, we need something, or rather, someone beyond ourselves. And do you know what about the disciple support system I liked? In their experience of suddenly, they knew where to go, and they knew to whom they ought to go.
they went to Jesus. They took their cares to Jesus. They took their fears to Jesus. They took their tears to Jesus. Shouldn't we do the same?
When we face the suddenlies of life, shouldn't we bend the knee and ask Jesus for sustaining grace? When we go through the suddenlies of life, those moments when the well runs dry, when tears become our food, when our hearts beat violently in our chests, when we feel weak and run over, shouldn't we go to Jesus?
Yes, my friend. When the suddenlies of life strike at the soul, the encouragement is to go to Jesus. I must tell Jesus all of my trials. I cannot bear these burdens alone. In my distress, he kindly will help me. He ever loves and cares for his own. I must tell Jesus all of my troubles. He is a kind, compassionate friend. If I but ask him, he will deliver. Make off my troubles quickly an end. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus. I cannot bear these burdens alone. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, Jesus will help me, Jesus alone. The disciples show us that we must go to Jesus.
And when we go to Jesus, we will find help. He who calms the rushing winds and roaring waters will still the storms of our hearts.
When we go to Jesus, we will find strength in our weakness. Eternal arms will bear us up.
When we go to Jesus, we will find solace for our broken spirits. When we go to Jesus, we will find the assurance of a shepherd who knows how to lovingly tend us. When we go to Jesus, we will experience him with open arms saying, "Come unto me, all who are weary and broken and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I am the bread of life. I will sustain you. I am the water that you need. I will quench the thirst you have."
All your anxieties, all your cares, take to the mercy seat and leave them there. Never a burden that he will not share. Never a friend like Jesus. Michael, Michelle, Rochelle, sometimes it will seem as if God is sleeping. Sometimes it will seem as if he's silent. It may seem that way, but I want you to know this: he is right there with you. He will never leave you. He will never, ever forsake you.
When the suddenness of life comes, we need a supportive system. We need a savior.
And with my final minute, I want to say to you, We need spiritual insight to navigate the suddenly of life.
Do you know, I read from verse 23 to 26, but do you know what verse 28 says? Verse 28 said, when they got to the other side,
I want to say to you, God has made a commitment to take you through this suddenly to the other side.
I don't know how long the effect of suddenly will last. I don't know how long your tears will flow. I don't know how long this hollow emptiness that you feel will last. I don't know how long the night will last. But I know that God is committed to taking you and taking us across this turbulent seas
to the other side. That is why Jesus says, I go to prepare a place for you. And I'm going to come back to receive you and to take you to be with me. God is committed to taking us to the other side. I don't like the word suddenly. But suddenly loses its power when I make Jesus in charge of my life. And I look forward to the continued sustaining grace of this Jesus as we navigate and face the various suddenlies of life. Rest eternal. Grant unto Marcia Erskine, and may light perpetual shine up on her. Amen.
I seem to be the one always inviting you to stand. So since it is my task, I so invite you. Please stand. Just to let Reverend Carlyle know that the word suddenly was one of the first words I ever learned. S-U-D, sud. Yes, I remember that word quite well, suddenly. Let us commend our sister Marcia to the mercy of God, our maker and redeemer. Deliver your servant Marcia, O sovereign Lord Christ, from all evil. Set her free from every bond, that she may rest with all your saints in the eternal habitations, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Marcia. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, in the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Into paradise may the angels lead you. At your coming, may the martyrs receive you and bring you into the holy city, Jerusalem. Amen.
Please be seated as we reflect together on the promise of God to bear us up on his wings.
in the shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow for life. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock, in whom I trust, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. The snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under his wings your refuge, his faithfulness your shield. Sing with me. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. For to his angels he's given a command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand, and hold you, hold you.
May I invite us just to bend our spirits and to close our eyes as we remember with fondness Marcia. Remember her smile. Remember the last conversation you had with her. Remember the last embrace you had. Remember the precious memories created with her. Release her spirit to God.
as you hold on to the memories of her in hopes of seeing her again. Rest eternal, grant unto Marcia Erskine, and may light perpetual shine on her. Amen. My dear friends, during the singing of the recessional hymn, the platform party will lead the recession on the third verse. We will be followed by the family member bearing the urn and other members of the family, and then others of us will follow the family. May I invite you, if you're able, to please stand for the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and grant you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the blessed Holy Spirit. Amen. The recessional hymn, The Lord of the Dance.
Danced in the morning when the world was begun, and I danced in the moon and the stars and the sun, and I came down from heaven and I danced on the earth. At Bethlehem I had my birth. Dance then wherever you may be, I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I lead you on wherever you may be, and I lead you on in the dance, said he. I danced for the scribe and the Pharisee, but they would not dance and they wouldn't follow me. I danced for the fishermen, for James and John, they came with me and the dance went on. Dance then wherever you may be, I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I lead you on wherever you may be, and I lead you on in the dance, said he. I dance for the sun, the holy people said it was a shame. They whipped and they stripped and they hung me on high and left me there on a cross to die. Dance then wherever you may be, I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I lead you all wherever you may be, and I lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced on the Friday when the sky turned black. It's hard to dance with the devil on your back. They buried my body and they thought I'd gone, but I am the dance and I still go on. Dance then wherever you may be, I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I lead you all wherever you may be, and I lead you all in the dance, said he. They cut me down and I leapt up high. I am the life that will never, never die. I live in you if you live in me. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. Dance then wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I lead you on wherever you may be, and I lead you on in the dance, said he.
My brothers and sisters, the repast is in the senior common room. The repast is in the senior common room. Thank you. Oh, sorry. The repast is at the Mona Visitors Lodge. The Mona Visitors Lodge.